Hey everyone, I'm Josh Farquharson. Before we begin, I just want to take a quick moment to applaud you for continuing to take steps toward a better future. Today, I'm going to introduce you to laboratory requisition forms, and later, you'll have an opportunity to get some hands-on practice. All right, let's get started. Doctors use laboratory tests to diagnose, screen for diseases, monitor treatments, and evaluate a patient's overall health. For routine care, it is common for patients to have their specimens collected at the doctor's office and for the doctor to send the specimens to the lab for testing. Once the patient's specimens are ready to go to the lab for testing, the healthcare provider completes a laboratory requisition form to communicate their testing needs to the lab. The name and design of the form may vary depending on the medical facility and laboratory. For example, a laboratory requisition form may also be referred to as a lab order form, lab requisition form, or test request form. The lab may accept the form manually, electronically, or both. No matter the name or type, if you are the person responsible for completing the form, you must complete it correctly. Otherwise, you may cause issues such as patient frustration, medical billing errors, lab test errors, and delays in test results. Remember, delays in receiving accurate test results may prevent the doctor from diagnosing and treating the patient effectively. Here's a scenario that illustrates a manual process where a healthcare provider performs the specimen collection in the office and sends the specimens out to a lab for testing. As you watch the scenario, try to identify when the form appears, who uses it, and how they use it.
Mary goes to the doctor's office for an examination. During the exam, Dr. T orders labs for the patient. The phlebotomist Mark reviews the patient's chart, verifies the patient's information, confirms the lab order, completes a lab requisition form, and selects the correct tubes and materials to fulfill the doctor's order. Mark then obtains the specimens from the patient and prepares them according to the laboratory's requirements. He packages the specimens and lab requisition form together into a biohazard specimen bag. Next, he places the package into a biohazard specimen lockbox and secures the lockbox on the office's exit door. A lab courier collects the specimen bag from the lockbox and delivers it to the lab for processing. The lab reviews the lab requisition form and performs the ordered test on the provided specimens. Once the test results are ready, the lab sends the report to Dr. T to review and share with Mary. Mary can also access her test results online through the patient web portal. The lab also uses the lab requisition form as a source document for billing purposes. If Mary has insurance coverage, the lab will use information from the lab requisition form, such as insurance details, diagnosis, and procedure codes, to create an insurance claim to send to the insurance company for payment. If Mary is responsible for a portion of the bill, the lab will bill Mary directly to collect payment.
All right, now that you have an idea of how lab requisition forms work, let's see what you remember. Based on the scenario, which of the following statements is false? The answer will appear in 3 seconds, so press pause to think about your answer. Here's the answer. Great job if you answered correctly. Next, we'll explore the form fields common to most lab requisition forms. A completed lab requisition form provides the lab with answers to the following questions. Who do the specimens belong to? What tests were ordered? Who ordered them and why? And who will pay the bill for lab testing services? Let's look at the information categories that align with these questions. Information on lab requisition forms typically fall under 3 main categories: patient details, provider and lab order details, and the insurance and responsible party details. Now let's take a closer look at each category. As mentioned previously, the information in the patient details category helps us answer the question, who do the specimens belong to? This category includes the patient demographic data and other identifying information commonly found on the patient registration form located in the patient's medical record. Let's review the form fields that correspond with the patient details category. The patient's legal name refers to the patient's last name, first name, and middle initial. Some forms use the term surname instead of last name. Sex refers to the patient's gender, and most forms require M for males and F for females. In the date of birth field, forms usually require dates to be entered in the two-digit month, two-digit day, and four-digit year format. The patient's ID number refers to the patient's account number, member number, record number, or other patient ID number required by the lab. The address and phone number fields refer to the patient's mailing address and phone number for receiving medical and billing communications. In most cases, the phone number format is 10 digits and includes the area code. As for the hospital status, the options are inpatient, outpatient, or non-patient. In a hospital setting, inpatient refers to a patient who is admitted into the hospital for medical care, typically for a day or more. Outpatient refers to a patient who visits the hospital for diagnosis or treatment, typically for a few hours or less. And non-patient refers to a person who is not physically present at a hospital, but has a specimen submitted to a hospital for analysis. The patient signature field is a critical form field. By signing the form, the patient agrees that the parties involved in their case, such as the lab and insurance company, can share their personal medical information if it is required to perform the services and obtain payment for those services. By signing, the patient also confirms that they may be responsible for paying for services not covered by their insurance company. Take a moment to see if you can identify the false statement. The answer will appear in 3 seconds, so press pause to give yourself some time to answer. And here's the answer. Great job if you answered correctly. Now that you understand the patient details category, let's explore the insurance and responsible party category. The information in the insurance and responsible party details category helps us answer the question, who will pay the bill for lab testing services? This category usually includes data from the patient's insurance ID card, along with other medical record details that are relevant to billing. Let's review the form fields that correspond to this category. In the responsible party area, the policyholder refers to the person who owns the insurance policy. This person can make changes to the policy and usually pays the insurance premiums that keep the coverage active. Other names for a policyholder include insured and subscriber. The insurance carrier field refers to the name of the health insurance company. Insurance companies are also called insurers or carriers. In cases where the patient has insurance coverage from more than one carrier, it is important to identify the carrier to bill first. In most cases, the primary carrier is billed first, leaving the secondary carrier to cover the remaining costs. The ID refers to the subscriber, policy, or member number commonly found on the front of the insurance ID card. The group number refers to the employer's health plan group number. If the policyholder is not part of their employer's group health plan, a group number may not be present on the card. The insurance address refers to the carrier's billing address commonly found on back of the insurance ID card. The name of the insured person refers to the policyholder's name. The relationship to patient field refers to the policyholder's relationship to the patient. If the patient is the policyholder, the patient is considered self-insured. If the patient is covered under someone else's policy, the patient is considered a dependent. And their relationship, such as a spouse, must be identified. The employer name field refers to the name of the employer providing the insurance policy to the insured. In the workers' comp field, marking yes on the form signifies to the lab that the patient's case is a workers' compensation case. Workers' compensation pays for medical care to treat employees who are injured or become ill because of their jobs. If the patient has Medicaid, include the Medicaid state and physician's provider number. The Medicare Advanced Beneficiary Notice of Non-Coverage, or ABN, helps patients make informed decisions about services Medicare usually covers but may not cover because they are medically unnecessary. When Medicare coverage denial is expected, the provider has the patient sign an ABN. By signing, the patient confirms that they received notice that they may be required to pay for the denied services. Based on what we've covered so far, which of the following statements is false? The answer will appear in 3 seconds, so press pause to think about your answer. And here's the answer. Great job if you answered correctly. Now that you understand the insurance and responsible party category, let's explore our final category, the provider and lab order details category. The information in this category helps us answer what tests were ordered, who ordered them, and why. This category includes the order tests, specimen details, the reason for the test, who ordered and authorized the test, who should receive the results, and other relevant details. Let's review the form fields that fit into this category. Many lab requisition forms have specimen identification labels. Each form has a unique set of labels that contain numbers or barcodes. Phlebotomists place the adhesive labels on specimen tubes for tracking purposes. Specimen tracking, also known as sample tracking, helps laboratories know who the specimens belong to and where the specimens are throughout the entire testing process. The collection date, time, and the patient's fasting status are critical elements for lab tests. To achieve accurate results, certain tests require a patient to fast and must be processed within a specific time frame. For urine chemistry tests, such as a 24-hour urine collection test, the urine hours per volume field refers to the urine collection time frame and the volume of urine collected within that time frame. The National Provider Identification Number, or NPI, refers to the unique identification number that healthcare providers receive under HIPAA's Administrative Simplification Standard. The physician's ID number can refer to the physician's group or network identification number, account number, or provider ID number that the lab requires. The physician's name and physician authorized signature fields refer to the healthcare provider who orders and authorizes the lab tests and services for the patient. The Send Additional Copy field refers to the additional healthcare providers who need to receive a copy of the patient's lab test results. Results are sent via fax, phone, mail, or other method depending on the recipient's preference. The International Classification of Diseases code set, such as the ICD-10-CM, is for diagnostic purposes under HIPAA. It is used to track healthcare and mortality statistics, quality outcomes, and billing. The diagnosis field refers to the reasons why the doctor ordered the tests, and those reasons must be entered on the form in the correct ICD code format. Most tests on lab requisition forms are organized into panels and categories. The names of the panels and categories can differ from one form to another, depending on the lab, provider specialty, and facility. Panels are groups of tests that are routinely ordered to determine a person's general health status. For example, a lipid panel includes tests such as a total cholesterol and triglycerides to assess a person's risk of developing heart disease. Categories include tests that share a common theme. For example, the microbiology and cultures category includes tests that detect the presence of bacteria and fungi in the specimen. Each category contains a list of test names. Some forms include a laboratory test identification number with a test name for tracking and efficiency purposes. Let's explore the additional information next to the test name. The current procedural terminology system is a standardized coding system for medical services and procedures. On this form, the CPT code is present next to the test name. Keep in mind that diagnosis codes and procedure codes should align with one another. For example, ordering a wound culture test and providing a diagnosis code for seasonal allergies doesn't exactly align, and that would risk non-payment for services, so make sure you enter codes accurately. Lab requisition forms will often include descriptors for the specimen collection materials required for certain tests. Common descriptors include tube stopper colors, such as lav for lavender or purple, gel for serum or plasma separated tubes containing gel, and swab for collecting specimens using a culture swab. The materials can vary based on laboratory requirements and the types of specimens being collected. The other test, additional test, and special instruction fields refer to areas on the form where physicians can order tests that are not listed on the form or provide special instructions for the ordered tests. All right, let's wrap up the lesson and see what you remember. Which of the following statements is false? The answer will appear in 3 seconds, so press pause to think about your answer. Here's the answer. Great job if you answered correctly. Now, if you have a few minutes, you'll want to take this opportunity to get some hands-on practice with lab requisitions at ahtlearn.com. Our mini courses help thousands of students just like you to learn quickly and perform well on the job. Listen, thank you so much for joining me today, and it's always a pleasure to teach you. Thank you once again for choosing Allied Health Tools. Stay blessed, everyone.